band started on the 41st day of summer for us, because when we were in high school, we considered summer the day that school ended. I don't know if it was the official 41st day of summer, but to us, when we were, you know, 16, summer started when school was over. And the day we started the band was 41 days after that. I mean, in high school, I wasn't much different than I am now. I still kind of dressed the same, had the same kind of hair to a certain degree. I was probably pretty quiet. I didn't have a ton of friends. Not much has changed, really. When we were starting out, we were a band called Casper, and that started in the 10th grade. And that was Steve-O and I and somebody else, a guy named Grant McVitie. And we went to the Warped Tour in 96. And these are all the kind of bands that we listened to, which was NOFX and Face to Face, Lagwagon, Pennywise. And Casper was kind of like, it leaned towards some of that, but wasn't fully into that kind of world of, you know, that kind of sound. So after going to the Warped Tour and seeing all these bands perform live, it was, you know, really exciting and really, it just kind of changed our world all of a sudden. We just said, we need to start a band that is more like this kind of style and can play on the Warped Tour. That was the dream. And from that day on, that was the 41st day of the summer for us. And we decided, you know, Casper is no more, the band is Sum 41. And it took a while before Dave and Cone joined. After that, from the beginning, we were always fans of different kinds of music. We always loved old school rap music. We loved metal. We loved Iron Maiden. We loved Metallica and Judas Priest, all that kind of stuff. Dave and Cone were friends of ours. We all went through high school together, and we'd known each other for a couple years at that point. Dave was the first to join, and that was in about 1998. So about 2 years after the band had already kind of been doing its thing. And Dave was in metal bands at the time, and you know, we turned him on to more punk rock music, and he turned us on to more metal music. When we changed from Casper into Sum 41, the songs changed quite a bit from Casper, but to the Sum 41 stuff is basically, it was kind of like a mix of, say, like NOFX meets Pennywise kind of stuff, and some of those songs kind of turned into what became Half Hour Power. Like a very early song was a song called Summer, and then a song called Machine Gun. And by the time we got to those songs were sort of not just sounding like NOFX and Pennywise anymore. They were kind of becoming what we felt like was our sound at the time. We had signed a record deal with Island Def Jam. They gave us a little bit of money to go in the studio. We went in for 2 weeks, and we just basically recorded our set list. That's all. That was every song we had, and that was in order what we used to do as our set, which we used to call the Half Hour Power set, because that's all we would ever play. We were always opening. We always only ever had 30 minutes. And so we just went in and recorded our set list, and it was really quick, really easy. And it was cool because Island Def Jam let us sell that at our shows for only $5. So that really helped people, you know, get to know the band. Wherever we went on tour, we were able to sell it for $5. So, you know, why not? People took the chance. It really helped get our name out there. When we were trying to get signed, the process was, you know, we were a Canadian band, and we sent out all our music to the Canadian labels first. Pretty much every single one of them passed on us. So then we decided, okay, well, let's take our chances and send it out to all the U.S. labels. Pretty much every label passed on it. And just by chance, we had made this video just for ourselves of us going around town, our hometown, and, like, spraying people with water guns, like, drive-by water gunning and doing all this dumb stuff. And we put our music over it, and it was really just for our friends. And our manager saw that and said, you know what, we should send this out to the labels because it has your music on it. It shows who you guys are and what you're all about. So we sent that out 2 weeks later after we'd just been rejected by everybody. And all of a sudden, every label wanted to sign us. They didn't even know that it was the same band. And all of a sudden, we had a bidding war with all these different major labels. Yeah, I mean, it was definitely, you know, pre-YouTube and stuff like that. I do know that, like, that tape got passed around. I don't know if the term was viral back then, if that's what they were using, but I definitely heard a lot of people coming up to us saying that, you know, it had been passed around quite a bit, and that's how they found out about us. With writing Fat Lip, it was kind of a weird one because it was really easy, but it was really difficult at the same time because all the parts for Fat Lip came rather simply, but they came spread out over like a year and a half. I would get just like a little bit. I remember getting that chorus, and I didn't really have anything else for 3 months. And then I would get the verse riff, but I didn't know what to do over it. And then there was like the bridge, and it just kind of got pieced together over about a year and a half. And then even recording vocally, it took a few attempts because it would be finished and we'd be ready. And I would listen to it. I just kept thinking it wasn't right. I didn't know what it was, so we would try to re-sing it. And it just took a long time. And then finally, it just clicked one day. And all of a sudden, all the pieces just kind of fit. The video reaction for me was really surprising because we were new to music videos. I didn't know if we made a good video or not. I knew we thought it was pretty cool. We'd played it for a few friends. I remember we played it for Benji and Joel from Good Charlotte. And they were one of the first people to see it. And they were one of the first ones to say, man, this video is great. And I thought, well, if those guys think it's good, maybe it is good. And then it came out about 2 weeks later, and you know, it started getting played, and it seemed that other people liked it as well. But it was a surprise to me. I didn't really know at the beginning. The process of recording All Killer, that took a while too, mostly because we went into the studio with only about 6 songs written. And remember Jerry Finn, the producer at the time, kept saying, you know, you'll probably write more as we get going. Once we get in the studio, you'll be inspired and you'll write more songs. The problem was is that we were partying way too much. We were 19 and we'd been given a bunch of money by the record company, and it was our first big record, and all we were doing was eating really expensive dinners and going out to strip clubs and doing whatever we felt like, everything except working, really. And we would get some work done, and it was just this like half and half of partying, but there was no writing being done. I couldn't write through all that. So we had to take a break after about, I don't know, 3 months. And then I wrote the rest of the record. And then we reconvened again and we got out of Toronto. We went to LA because we weren't old enough to go to bars yet. And so the label wanted us to get away from all our friends and all the distraction. And we finished the record in LA. The cover for All Killer was just, I mean, like a lot of those things, they just sort of happened. We weren't really thinking of what should we do for a cover. There was a Polaroid camera just sitting around one day at a photo shoot, and we started making all these stupid faces and taking our own photos, and we had a whole bunch of them. We put them up on a board, again, just to like make other people laugh. It was like, it had nothing to do with anything. We just stuck them all up on this big bulletin board, and people were looking at it, and somebody just said, you know what, that should be your record cover. And we said, all right, yeah, cool. I think the inspiration behind Does This Look Infected was being on the road. I mean, when we came off the All Killer tour, I think we ended on like May 7th. And by May 8th, I was working on new music. And I'd been writing a lot of riffs and stuff like that on the road already. So I had a lot of ideas. And within, I think it was about 6 weeks or so, I just kind of put all those riffs to songs and turned them and put lyrics to it and just, you know, quickly put those songs together. And we went down to New York and recorded that record in another couple weeks. And we already had a tour booked, so we only had a small window. We only had, I think, 6 or 8 weeks to really get the whole thing done. So we did that. We weren't finished when we had to go on tour, so we took recording on the road with us, and we were recording in different cities in Europe while we were out on tour. With the Chuck album, I don't know if there was any real discussion about having it being heavy or having soft moments or having dynamics through it. It's just, like every record, they're just songs that just sort of come out. And I always think that the music comes from life experience and just sort of what I'd just been going through previously. I don't really know how it comes out in music, but I feel like it does. And for whatever reason, I guess everything that we'd been living at that time sort of directed my songwriting to go that way. I think some standout moments from, say, the beginning up until Chuck. I know one of the first ones would have been when we performed on the MTV 20th anniversary special. And we were relatively unknown. We were still pretty new. Fat Lip was out, but it wasn't really, you know, it hadn't done what it was going to do yet. And We played Fat Lip, but we also asked Rob Halford from Judas Priest and Tommy Lee from Motley Crue to come play a couple songs. So we did a Priest song. We also did a Beastie Boys song and a Motley Crue song. And after that, that next day, everything kind of changed. Like the video went up in rotation. The song started getting played more on radio. Everyone just kind of started recognizing us more on the street, everything just kind of changed. And from that point on, it just kind of grew and grew. And that was kind of like the turning point, really. By the time we got to Does This Look Infected, I guess one of the standout things was that just how our touring had gotten significantly bigger around the world. Like, all of a sudden we were able to do arenas in the UK and in Japan and all these other places that we really hadn't been to a lot. All of a sudden it was just a whole different thing. And that was really exciting because that's what we do. We love to play live. And then on the Chuck album, was right before the Chuck album was coming out, still when there was still writing going on, we went to the Congo to shoot a documentary on the effects of the Civil War that had been going on there. And that whole experience was crazy for a lot of reasons because, I mean, there was a ceasefire there for a year and a half, so there was no fighting. It was just the effects of the Civil War. And to go through and see all that and talk to so many people and see what they were living through and trying to, how they were trying to turn that country around. Only after about 10 days of us being there, the war started back up and we were caught in the middle of it and we were stuck there for 3 days. And I mean, there's a whole documentary about it. I don't need to go into the entire thing. You can watch it on YouTube. That was probably one of the craziest experiences of my life. Doing Underclass Hero was a different record in many ways. I mean, Dave was newly, he had left the band. Tom was not in the band yet. We were just a three-piece. We didn't have a producer at the time, so I ended up producing it more of just out of necessity, not by choice, really. We just never got that far with anyone. We met a bunch of people, but we never really connected with anybody. And then it came time to record, and we just went in and did it because we felt the songs were the songs already. Not much was going to change. So we got a great engineer, Doug McKeon, and went in there and just did our best. And then after that, right after the record was done, is when Tom joined the band. I tend to write alone anyway, so the writing side of it didn't really change for me. It was more of the recording process. We usually like to record as a band, and it was just three of us instead of the four of us at that point. The touring cycle of Underclass Hero with Tom was a lot of learning for all of us. It was definitely different. But, I mean, Tom was also in a band that we grew up listening to, a band called Gob, and we were fans of, and it's a great punk rock band from Canada, and he fit in pretty easily, right away. With Scream Bloody Murder, it was a kind of a totally different thing. For the first time, I wasn't really ever trying to write a record. Songs were just kind of coming out here and there, and I never really felt like I sat down and said, okay, now we're going to do a record. They felt like they just magically appeared, because I was never sitting down to write anything. It just, one day I'd write something, and then I'd go off and do my own thing and not really think about that song. A couple weeks later, another song would just kind of come out of nowhere, and I'd record that and forget about it. And after about a year of that, I kind of was interested to see what I had done, and I went back and looked, and I found that I had, I don't know, like 12 songs or something like that. So I started showing them to the guys, and everyone felt like, okay, well, it looks like we have a record here, I guess. We should probably start thinking about recording. And then that's kind of how that record started. Once we got into the studio, I had a pretty clear vision, production-wise, that I just wanted that record to sound like it was a full band just playing, and we were just recording the band playing live, which is pretty much what we did. We all just went in and just recorded, and it was relatively quick. We lived in a house up in the Hollywood Hills, and then those guys left after a couple weeks. I stayed and did vocals and guitars and whatever I had to do, and it was a really fun experience. It was relatively quick, although we would finish the record, but I wrote three more songs right at the very end, so we kind of had to like delay the record release, go and record these three songs, and that took a little bit of time, and it ended up coming out the year after it was supposed to come out. But other than that, it was a relatively simple record. Three songs were Baby You Don't Want to Know, Time For You to Go, and Blood in My Eyes. Blood in My Eyes being the one that I really felt strongly about, and since we had the other two, we thought we might as well record them. But Blood in My Eyes was really the reason why we wanted to go and push the release and make sure that song got on. And it's probably one of my favorite songs, and it was nominated for a Grammy, so I guess we did the right thing. Well, I would say for about a year to 2 years before Dave joined the band again, we started reconnecting just as friends. He had reached out to me, and which we didn't really speak that much while he was away. We weren't mad at each other. There was no fight or anything like that. We just didn't really cross paths. And once he reached out, we just started talking after that, and we became closer and closer. And then it just got to a point where we just said, like, why are we not playing together anymore, you know? And we just started talking about the process of him coming back and what that would look like, and you know, talking to the other guys about it. And we all agreed that we would love Dave to come back. And we were in the middle of writing and recording a new record at the time, so it was a matter of like, well, when does this happen? And you know, the AP Awards was the first thing that was coming up that we were going to perform. We thought, well, that would be a perfect place to show that Dave's back. Now that we're a five-piece and we have three guitar players, I mean, it's really exciting for me because, I mean, they're both such great guitar players. Tom and Dave are both amazing, and they both play so differently. And I'm really happy, just like, I like playing rhythm guitar, and I like writing music and leaving places for those guys to be able to do things. Like, it's fun for me as a writer to know that I could write something that they're gonna play way better than I can play, or take it to a different place. And just leaving places for guitar solos, which I don't really do. I can produce that, I can watch what those guys do and sort of like guide that along, and we've got a good rhythm together. As far as the new record goes, it's an energetic, aggressive, fun, live sounding record to me. I started writing the day that I got home off the 13 Voices tour, mostly because I was so inspired by being on the road and being on stage every night and seeing the reaction from the fans of the new songs, the old songs, and everything in between, that it just made me want to get back out there and play new music again. So everything feels like it's written to be played live, because that's just kind of the way I write, because we're on tour so much. It's just everything has to work live to me. I don't really think too much about the future and what to do or what we're going to do. I just sort of, it's all about the feeling to me. I just wake up and I just sort of do what I feel, and music comes from an honest place for me, and it's just how I feel at the time, and I just follow it. Hey, what's up? This is Derek from 741. For more videos from your favorite artists, like or subscribe to APTV.